Good afternoon and welcome to the Full Scottish in Broadcasting Scotland. My name's Corri Wilson and our guests this week are Professor John Robertson and Lisa Peebles. Welcome to you both.
Hi there.
We're obviously going to have a bit of a busy programme today. I think there's been much happening through the week.
Not a quiet week.
No. We'll kick off with Brexit. Now obviously on Wednesday we saw Theresa telling us that the Cabinet had collectively agreed the deal. But that was very quickly followed on Thursday morning by the resignations, which included Dominic Raab, who ironically said that there was fatal flaws in the draft Brexit agreement, the one that he was part of negotiating. And then obviously Theresa had 3 hours in the House of Commons with some hostile questioning. But then she felt the need to have a press conference that night. And I wonder, why do you think that was, John? Was she trying to gain control,
I guess you must know that there is no support for any of the options. I mean, no matter what you come up with here, that you'd be hard pushed to get a majority in the House of Commons. So I guess she's panicking. I don't really know why she's continued so long. I mean, it's really, I find it hard to like her in any way, for obvious reasons. But there's one aspect of her determination and her stamina are astonishing. And so I think she thinks she can go all the way. I think she thinks she can get approval. Mm-hmm. But all the evidence is that she won't. It's not going to happen. So presumably that was an attempt to squeeze out. Mm-hmm. And she's been on the phone, I gather, speaking to people all over the country in a desperate effort. But I don't think this goes through the House of Commons. And then I think we're in really uncharted waters. Mm-hmm. And I think we're heading for another election probably.
Lisa, she seemed to be very defiant. Do you think that was her sending a warning shot to her critics?
I think she is. She's in a no-win situation here, because what she's in fact trying to do are two separate things. She's trying to save her party as well as, you know, guide the country through, you know, this incredible mess that is Brexit. So, and both of them, although they are incredibly connected, I think to achieve one, she's going to lose the other. Yeah. So she's in some way, you know, probably, despite the fact that my politics are entirely different from hers, she's probably the one person who actually has had a bit of a principled stance in this whole thing, because nobody else is acting on principle. None of the rest of the members of her party are acting on principle. You know, they're acting in, you know, real self-interest. And what they've created is a culture of blame. Yeah. You know, and you see that with Dominic Raab immediately resigning after he failed to do his job. You know, so he's then created this situation where he's pointing the finger back at her and saying it was her failure. But in fact, it's his job.
One of the astonishing things was that there didn't appear to be a single mention of Scotland in the paper, 500 odd pages. Do you think that was just a step too far, John? I mean, it's totally disrespectful.
It looks that way. It looks that way. I think that they have a rationale for it. They think there's nothing special to be said about Scotland, and at a purely rational level, they're correct. But it's remarkably naive psychologically for them to have done that. They must have realised. And so that could be interpreted as direct provocation, that willingness to just, you know, to do that and not to think, well, we must do something to say something about Scotland here, and just to be prepared to drop it entirely. So that was a shock for me, and it's a very simple assessment of the thinking behind a particular project if there isn't a mention. And 100 mentions of Ireland, 30 for Gibraltar. Astonishing.
I think there was lots of backlash, particularly in Scotland, in social media, with regards of there was no mention of Scotland. I think that backfired on them.
I think that's an indicator of where we're at. You know, she knows that she doesn't need to mention us, because in fact there's very little, the, you know, in terms of power that Scotland actually has in this negotiation. You know, Ireland and the huge consideration that's been given to the Northern Irish issue has a huge impact in their ability to deliver Brexit. So they have decided that they're going to focus their attention on the things that they really need to do, and actually we're not that important.
Well, they think, you know, I think they think, and perhaps they have some reason to think that, they think that the Scots are still scared.
Aye.
And we'll still be stuck at 45%, and the opinion polls are not that encouraging, despite this year and more of complete chaos, with the performance of the Conservatives being, you know, spitting image, like, in terms of, and the ludicrous characters that have come forward to in their leadership in the Conservative Party. You would think this would have been an open goal for, for the Yes campaign, but it hasn't proved to be the case. There's still this kind of stubbornness in the population, or fear amongst so many. It's really quite disheartening in some ways.
We as a movement have failed to convince those people who were not already in agreement that there's something better to that can come. So that's for us to take on, but we can't point the finger at the machinations of Westminster, what's happening there. That's our responsibility. We need to go out there and convince people.
I agree, but I don't think it would be appropriate for the Yes campaign to beat itself up over this, because the reason that people are not shifting, I don't think, is about rational debate, about evidence. It's about deeply held feelings. Deeply held feelings about being afraid of change, so especially amongst older people like myself. I think these are, it's very hard to turn that around. You can talk to people for ages and they can agree with your arguments and they can see that rationally you've made a good case for independence. But if they're deeply fearful of it, they're not going to shift.
I think you mentioned Northern Ireland, Lisa, and I don't think anybody would grudge the special deal for Northern Ireland given its circumstances. But would you agree, John, that this puts Scotland at a distinct disadvantage?
Well, it looks like it could work both ways. I mean, on balance, probably would be the case, because Northern Ireland will have a much smoother arrangement of trading with the European Union. That would seem to advantage them quite a bit. So you could see potentially a risk of the movement of activity from Scotland to Northern Ireland. Mind, weighed against that, it will make things slightly more difficult for the Northern Ireland to trade with the rest of the UK. Scotland might have an advantage in that. But the European Union is much bigger than the UK, so they have, at least in terms of potential, much greater opportunity to thrive with this new deal.
And we've talked about Theresa May. I mean, what do you think's next for her, Lisa? I mean, will there be a vote of no confidence? Are they going to get enough letters? Is she going to resign? Is she going to be pushed? Do we have a general election? What do you think?
Well, just
next?
Before I came here this morning, I was listening to the chair of the 1922 committee on the radio, and he was really clear that they do not have enough letters yet. He was also very clear, and I found this quite interesting, that there have been occasions, both under his chairmanship and previous chairmanships, where party members have come out and said, I have written a letter to the chair, and actually they haven't. You know, but because of the nature of his role, he actually is not able to say, well, you know, you, Joe Bloggs, it said you'd written a letter, you haven't. So there's it was quite interesting to hear that. I mean, I don't know enough about the internal wranglings of the Tory party at Westminster to know whether they're going to get those numbers, but I think there's part of me, you know, just cannot escape the fact that the people who are fighting so hard against her in public actually don't want the job now, because this she is going to fail, whoever, you know, is the person who, you know, leads this sinking ship through, you know, the sea of Brexit, is going to fail. So your Jacob Rees-Mogg's, your, you know, Boris Johnson's, they might say one thing in public, but they don't want this job. You know, so in many ways, the whole idea that there's going to be a vote of no confidence is a bit of a mute point, because there's actually not going to be anybody who's going to come and take her place, because it's going to be a nightmare.
And I think that's a key point, you know, in the event that Theresa did go, who on earth would replace her?
There's no obvious candidate at all. And there is no one who could command support anywhere near the level she commands. I mean, she might have a bare majority amongst MPs, quite a tight one, I think. I mean, I could see her potentially losing a vote of no confidence, but she still is well ahead of the others. I mean, opinion polls give some of the others, 4-7%, that kind of thing. They know that. They know that. So they, as you say, they're playing this game of you know, poking the bear to some extent, but they don't want to really tackle it.
No,
they want the whole thing to fall apart, I think, and perhaps some completely dramatic change after an election. But I think they're starting to worry about that as well, because the opinion polls at last are starting to swing against them. For quite a long time, I mean, the opinion polls have still held the Tories in first place.
I think that is a real indicator of some of the shift in thought down in England. I mean, just the other week there, I was speaking to somebody who I know very, very well, who was in, like, an older, retired guy, lives in the South England, although Scottish by birth, and he had voted for Brexit. Hmm. And he had voted for Brexit for all of the quite uncomfortable reasons that we know that people did. And he was really clear that he now understood that what he was going to get was nothing at all like what he actually thought he was going to get. So there's a kind of a shift and a split there, so it's not clear where those people are actually going to take their votes and take their kind of power base to, but it's definitely, there's definitely movement in that.
I think in terms of if there was another general election, and in the event of Jeremy Corbyn becoming PM, but he's already said that he pledged to honour the referendum vote, so where would that leave us as well?
I think that's a very hard one to read. He's very much part of the old Labour Party, mm-hmm. who were opposed to the European Union, because the European Union is largely a neoliberal economic project, mm-hmm. and you can see why they're opposed to it. They're also wedded to the idea that migration reduces the working conditions and wages of working class people. Mm-hmm. Now, we have evidence that that's not true, but the old Labour Party are very much strongly tied to that notion. So I think he's got limited scope for movement. He knows that if he were to move towards, you know, second referendum and so on, that perhaps that would gain him a lot of middle class votes. But mm-hmm. I think they're still anxious about losing working class mm-hmm. votes in certain areas. Mm-hmm. And it's so tight. I mean, I think we're at about equal 40% mm-hmm. at the moment. So I think they're standing, watching the situation, thinking this, it will be time to do something at some point, mm-hmm. but it's still not time. Mm-hmm. And I think we could run for quite a while here with the Labour Party without the confidence to actually say, right, we will support mm-hmm. a second referendum and take a chance on that in an election. They won't do that quickly, I don't think.
Mm-hmm. And of course, we've had Theresa for months telling us that no deal was better than a bad deal. Mm-hmm. And now it turns out she's saying that really this deal was better than a no deal. Which do you think it is, Lisa? Does she not even know?
It's like putting a crystal ball in front of me, you know, or tarot cards or something. Nobody knows. The whole idea that a bad deal might be better than a no deal, I mean, what does that even mean? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, there's going to be a deal. The deal might be, you know, we're going to just revert back to World Trade Organization, you know, rules and regulations. So there will be a deal, but it just might not be a deal that was negotiated. You know, everything's not going to stop. It's just going to become very, very messy.
There are too many uncontrollable variables in an economy. Aye. Nobody really knows what will happen. Predictions are made, but we know from history that economists are very good in retrospective.
Aye.
They can look back at events and say, oh, we understand why the slump took place. But they're typically wrong mm-hmm. in predicting the future. So whether this is a good deal or a mediocre deal or whatever, no one really knows. And I think you'd only find out if you were to actually implemented.
I think we'll know in 10 years' time.
Yeah.
That's when we're going to know mm-hmm. whether a deal has been a good deal or no, because it's not something that we are in any way able to predict at the moment. No. Even when you look at the intricacies of it and think, well, if they did this, then that would... You know what? We simply do not know. There are so many things that can change between now and the 31st of March or whenever it's actually implemented. Who knows that?
I think you picked up earlier on some of the reasons why people voted to leave the uh-huh. EU. And do you think part of that, or a big part of that, is the role in the media were involved in the outcome of that vote?
I think so. They played a very big part. I mean, much of what we think of as reality, I mean, for many of us, is instructed by the mm-hmm. media. I mean, where else do you get your information from? You get it from, you know, from Reporting Scotland or STV mm-hmm. and so on. So that I think whether or not they were biased is another matter. But I think there's definitely evidence that would require a proper study. Definitely evidence that the BBC have not been critical enough of the Leave campaign. That they allowed too much to pass without scrutiny there. And there was a lot of evidence out there that what the Leave campaign were coming up with was not really underpinned by any kind of real evidence. Mm. So I think they were a bit soft on that, and I think that may have enabled the victory to some extent, the media response. That's leaving aside the newspapers that were actively Brexit, but, you know, with readership declining fast, I think it's the television performance really that's more important here.
I think it's a real mistake for us to focus on just the media as being the reason why people voted. You know, there are some really uncomfortable views held by people who voted to yeah. leave. And, you know, we do a disservice to everybody if we don't actually front them up and face them and try and you know, and not be dismissive of what they're saying just because we fundamentally disagree with it or we find it uncomfortable. Because actually to dismiss people and not to listen, or to dismiss the entirety of their political yeah. reasoning because one bit of it, you know, makes us feel really uncomfortable is exactly the reason why we're in this situation. Yeah. And you know, you're talking about the Labour Party and the working class votes, that's exactly the reason why they're in that situation, is because they've dismissed the views because they are uncomfortable.
Well,
actually, we just need to get a grip and address these things.
But do you think, John, that it's the media's job to challenge politicians, or is it their job to present the facts to allow the public to make their own mind up?
Well, we have this powerful myth in the UK that we have a free press and that we have impartiality in the BBC and so on. Now, we all know there are certain limits to how true that is, but it's fairly clear that the BBC has a charter, and that charter requires them to present the evidence of both sides, at least both sides, of any kind of debate. And it's certainly, well, we've been anxious for some time about the BBC's coverage of the independence campaign. I think some people south of the border have, for the first time, started to question the BBC when they look at the coverage of the, I mean, the presence of Nigel Farage, for example. Huge presence on Question Time and elsewhere. And I think there's, you know, the media will say, well, we're reacting to what's happening out there. But I think there's a certain naivety in that. I think they play a part in influencing what's out there. And I think their willingness to accept Leave campaign statements without really exposing them to kind of critique, I think has to be looked at negatively now. We have to think, well, you know, that may have played a part.
One of the casualties or the resignations was Esther McVeigh, and that kind of links into our next topic, which was the UN special report visit to the UK for, you know, the 12-day visit. And people are now suggesting that perhaps that was one of the reasons why Esther went. Now, this was a very damning report where he said that the UK government are entrenching high levels of poverty and inflicting unnecessary misery in one of the richest countries of the world. These are strong words, John. Do you think he was right?
Absolutely. I mean, I have no reservations about that at all. Austerity is a consequence of political actions. It's not something that happens naturally in a modern, advanced society. There is clearly far more being produced, far more wealth being produced than is being consumed by people in many parts of the country. So it's fairly clear cut. The austerity policies were deliberate. It's an ideological attack on the welfare state, and that's had dramatic effects. I mean, I think there is some evidence that the Scottish Government have had some success in moderating these, and the report did mention that. The report did give credit in two or three places. In fact, the only real credit was given to anything was to the attempts of the Scottish government to introduce initiatives that would reduce the effect of poverty. But it's an appalling scandal. I mean, I think historians will look back on this with incredulity, to look back at the level of wealth in the country, the amount of wealth being generated in the country, and yet at the same time people living in these circumstances.
He also said that people who are in benefits are reminded constantly that they're lucky to get anything at all. And I think that brings it back to the media point of this demonisation of people in benefits, that they're scroungers, that it's a life choice. Would you agree that plays a big part?
Well, it's another hostile environment, isn't it? I mean, Theresa's famous for her hostile environment towards migrants in the Windrush scandal. And I think there's a hostile environment now in that part. And the disabled are, you know, major victims of this, and we see massive increases in suicide rates being linked. I mean, it's not in any way something we can just talk about calmly and coolly, because this is having dramatic and traumatic effects on parts of the population. So, I mean, I just find it astonishing that so many people are still, despite this, wedded to their support for the Conservative Party, and an opinion poll still coming out with 40%. You think, do they look at this? Do they see these stories? Do they see the story of the United Nations Rapporteur? And do they think either it's not true, or do they think that we just don't care as long as we're okay? Because, I mean, the last budget gave the opportunity for this government to do something about austerity. There was money available, and they chose to spend the money elsewhere, on middle-income taxation cuts and upper income taxation cuts. So,
Lisa, he also said that the system makes it unwelcoming as possible, and he said that it was a disgrace, a social calamity, and an economic disaster all rolled into one. Are people falling through the net?
I think people are definitely falling through the net, and I think he's right to highlight it in such strong terms, because it is a horrific situation. It's a horrific situation for us as a society, but when you're the person who is being affected by it, it's incredibly difficult. And I personally believe that, you know, we know enough about, for example, universal credit and the failure of that to be rolled out appropriately, to, you know, any, you know, sensible person to look at it and say, actually, this has been a mistake. You know, maybe how it was intended to be, you know, had some benefit, but in fact how it's actually been rolled out and what it's doing in practice is, you know, not what it was intended. So to answer the question that you had mentioned, John, about, you know, are the Tory party looking at this and thinking, well, we don't believe it or they don't care, I just don't think it matters to them. I don't think it's that important, because they see themselves as being, you know, hard-working people who, you know, don't experience poverty because they put in the grind, whereas the people who are maybe cleaning their houses or washing their motors are working twice as hard but for less, but they don't see that because they don't put the same value on the skills of other people. So it's a complete shock. The statistic that I just thought was horrific was that it's almost now one in two children are existing in poverty. I mean, what's that all about? One in two? I mean, that's just like, you know, every second Wayne that you'll see in the street is experiencing the impact, the direct impact of Conservative austerity policy. And, you know, I'm not prepared to accept that.
You also said, John, that austerity was a political desire to undertake social re-engineering rather than economic necessity. He called it an ideology, and he said it hadn't led to many savings. And you mentioned that the Scottish Government was mentioned, but they've been saying this all along, it was an ideology. Yeah. Would you agree?
Well, I think the Conservatives often present themselves as non-ideological. They're often very proud of this notion that they're not non-ideological. But everybody knows that everything is ideological. Mm-hmm. And people who try to claim they're not ideological, they're largely using that to conceal what are commonly right-wing ideologies, mm-hmm. which they think somehow are almost biblical and somehow appropriate. So I think from going back to George Osborne, who starts all of this, really, you have an ideological attack on the welfare state, mm-hmm. essentially. The Conservative Party, since Margaret Thatcher, has abandoned the idea that that this is a country for everyone, mm-hmm. you know, and they had their one nation conservatism, as they called it. There were flaws in that. Mm-hmm. But until Margaret Thatcher, I think there was a willingness to accept that some kind of consensus was required, mm-hmm. and that the welfare state and the NHS and so on were required for the country to become affluent, for the rich to succeed. Mm-hmm. The rich would benefit from that. Crime levels would be lower and so on. But from Thatcher onwards, I think we have an abandonment of that, and it's still with us. And Esther McVeigh is a classic child of Thatcher, mm-hmm. very much a child of Thatcher, somebody who poses on websites wearing new shoes and that kind of thing, and is clearly unfeeling with regard to people working, you know, people being treated by the DWP. I was in danger of getting mixed up with the DUP and the DWP. It's quite interesting, they're very similar.
What's the worst?
I'm wondering, yes, are they similar kind of thinking on some issues, maybe Old Testament thinking. Did I answer your question?
He also spoke about, he said this system was draconian across the board, and he also said that when he spoke to ministers, they were in denial. Mm-hmm. The thing about this visit seems to be that it's largely going unnoticed in the media. Is this deliberate, or is it getting sort of buried within the Brexit stuff that's high on the agenda? You know, does it suit this government that it's not up there for everybody to see?
I mean, I don't know. I don't necessarily subscribe to the theory that there's a conspiracy to hide it. I think what's actually happened, because it is pretty damning, and I think what's actually happened is that the horrific, ridiculous situation that we found ourselves in with Brexit this week has just overshadowed everything. But I think this is a really, really powerful report, and I would encourage everybody to read it if they've not yet had the opportunity, because it's I think it's, I would hope that it is grabbed by other people out there and used as a mechanism to try and affect change, because it carries real weight. You know, this is the UN Special Rapporteur. It's no, you know, somebody who's, you know, just decided that they were going to sit and write something up. This is a really serious piece of work that's evidenced. So
I think you were correct in saying there's no conspiracy involved here. I mean, I don't think that wouldn't be possible, because the government, the UK government, has no control over a UN release by an academic there. So I think the fact it's been caught up in the storm of Brexit is just something that would have happened for anything. Mm-hmm. Where there was some possibility for it to get the kind of audience it deserves is in the media coverage. Mm-hmm. And while the Guardian and the Independent and to some extent the Scottish press have given it some attention, it's been pretty much pushed down in the rest of the press. Mm-hmm. And the television news coverage has been quite limited, because again, they're seduced by Brexit, mm-hmm. Brexit and the personality politics mm-hmm. that they love so much. So that's where there was scope, I think, for people to maybe to write in and complain about the way the media have neglected mm-hmm. this hugely important report.
And kind of sticking with the media, but we're going across the pond. I don't know if you saw during the week Trump's atrocious behaviour towards a CNN reporter, Jim Acosta, which led to his pass being revoked. Is this acceptable behaviour for a president?
It's astonishing. If you had shown me a film of Donald Trump as president, even 10 years ago, I would have been utterly convinced it was a spoof. Mm-hmm. Utterly convinced. Mm-hmm. Nobody could have convinced me that was at all possible. And there have been some, you know, ridiculous characters in politics before. Mm-hmm. I mean, had television been much more prevalent in the 1920s and 30s in Italy, Mussolini would have been laughed mm-hmm. off the stage. I mean, there have been ludicrous figures right through, but Trump seems to be something very special in that sense. And I don't mean that in a good way. Mm-hmm. He's a cartoon character, and his behaviour is borderline fascist, mm-hmm. I would say. Mm-hmm. Very anti-democratic, certainly. Mm-hmm. I think that particular gentleman has got his pass back.
Yes.
It's been a judge revoked it. Mm-hmm. So he hasn't been able to change the behaviour of all the judges yet, but he's doing his best, of course, to get the judges on his side.
Yeah, as you say, the Washington DC court ordered that pass is returned, but Trump's response was that he's threatening in the future to walk out if reporters don't act with decorum. Mm-hmm. Is that a wee bit ironic, Lisa?
Well, I mean, what can I say about Trump that's not already been said? I think there's been like a coup d'etat in America, and he's been used as a sort of cartoon-like figurehead, but it's what's behind him that's propelled him forward, where the real fascism sits. Yeah. He's an idiot. Mm-hmm. You know, he's got no intellectual capacity that's worth anything, and the people behind him funding him know that. Yeah. He's just the fall guy, he's just a figurehead, and the way he behaves, and, you know, in his tweets, in his, you know, horrific approach to, you know, the commemorations in France last week, all of that is just a distraction.
He does.
It's so as everybody's focusing on, oh, Trump, isn't he an idiot? Look at what he's done now. And instead of actually looking about what's behind him, what's got him there.
That's right.
Because that's where the real problems lie.
The corporations, the military industrial complex, and so on. Aye. I mean, he serves a purpose.
Aye.
And as you said, he's a front man.
Aye.
And the more ludicrous he is, the more the media love that.
Aye.
And they may criticise him. But they love it. They love that.
It sells papers and it gets, you know, clicks. So,
but are we in danger of normalising that behaviour by media reaction?
I think it is normalised for a lot of people. I mean, I'm horrified, not so much about him. I'm horrified about when I see people who support him. I mean, I was in Athens a couple of weeks ago. I was sitting on a bench and two older ladies came and sat beside me and my friend. We were chatting and they were saying that they had voted from the South in America. They'd voted before they left and they'd voted for Trump. And they were absolutely convinced. These were intelligent women. But these women were saying that they had voted for Trump because they were protecting free speech and stopping socialism. I mean, that's what they believed that they were voting for. And, you know, it led to an incredibly interesting conversation.
Mm-hmm. And where do they get that kind of feeling from, this idea that the United States is under threat from socialism? They get it from the media and from the education system. One of the things that over the years has interested most about the independence movement in Scotland, mm-hmm. people have been sometimes quite demoralised at the slow progress being mm-hmm. made. But I look back at 300 years of school education based on imperial history with no Scottish education in it whatsoever. That changing that will take decades.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that these people who support Trump, sometimes I think they're aware enough to realise they're supporting Trump because he backs certain things, mm-hmm. like right-wing Supreme Court judges, mm-hmm. or he backs certain attitudes towards the church and so on. They know that in other ways he behaves badly, in ways they don't like,
mm-hmm.
but they're kind of pragmatic about it. They say, well, at least he supports this,
aye.
This thing that we like. Yeah.
But do you think it's you know, similar to him and to Theresa and the Tory party, they all seem to adopt these sound bites, mm. taking back control, and
yeah,
that seems to resonate with people.
It does, unfortunately, yeah. I think we know that from the history of propaganda. We are from Nazi Germany, mm-hmm. and onwards.
Mm-hmm.
We know that these sort of things work. We're a social animal,
mm-hmm.
and put people in the crowd, and they often behave ways in which you wouldn't quite like them to behave.
And it's easier for people to take complex arguments and yeah. complex issues and just make yeah. them simple.
Mm-hmm.
You know, turn them into sound bites, because actually sometimes thinking about politics and stuff like that is pretty hard.
Mm-hmm.
Thinking about your place in the world and your yeah. place in society is pretty hard. If somebody's going to come to you and say, you know, here's three lines that's going to explain everything to you and I'm going to deliver it for you, you know, for some people that's a really comfortable option, because, you know, the complexities of life and the difficulties they're experiencing,
yeah.
you know, are very, very hard.
It can make you quite, in some ways, quite glad, really, when you watch First Minister's questions, and you, despite the awful sort of things said by some of the people from the Conservative benches, it's nothing compared to what's happening elsewhere. Scottish mm. Parliament seems to operate in quite a rational, fairly polite
aye.
Sort of way, and I mean, it's almost a model by contrast.
Mm-hmm.
And the contrast is really quite sharp.
Mm-hmm.
The shouting and braying at Westminster, and then and the manic behaviour across the United States puts it in quite good light, I think.
And I think all of that is all just about entitlement.
Yeah.
You know, I have a voice and I'm entitled to use it, and, you know, I'm going to attack people rather than I'm going to come up with a solution.
Mm.
It's much easier to do that. It's much easier for me to say you're wrong than it is for me to say here's a different way to solve that problem. So.
And you mentioned France earlier on, Lisa, and this week Trump has taken umbrage to President Macron, who lectured him on the danger of nationalism. So Trump took to Twitter and he said that the French would be speaking German today if it wasn't for the US military support during the both wars. That's just an embarrassing response, isn't it, John?
It is a bit, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because really the Russians played the larger part in absorbing the German threat.
And I think what we've also seen is that his wife seems to have taken a leaf out of his book, and she was demanding the scalp of a top aide,
mm.
all because of a seat on a flight.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what are we dealing with here?
I think, you know, if you think back to when he was elected,
mm.
and there was all that, you know, stuff about Melania, save Melania. Melania's, you know, clearly, you know, being subject to some sort of control by mm. him. She is complicit,
mm.
you know, she is part of this, you know, and just because she finds the whole scrutiny element incredibly uncomfortable, which, by the way, I can understand, because who would want to subject themselves or their family to that? But just because she does not cope well with it does not mean to say that she's not part of it. It's if she has got somebody within that she is working with, you know, it's like anything, we all need to work with people that sometimes we don't like, but we need to make it work. If she thinks that by publicly coming out and shaming somebody who's, you know, who may have behaved badly, who would know?
Yeah.
If she thinks that's the appropriate way for a first lady or for any employer to deal with somebody who is a de facto employee, then it kind of, you know, it exposes more about her than it does about the situation.
Yeah. A positive outcome, there may be a positive outcome here, I'm always looking for one, is that the Democrats are clearly changing at the moment in opposition. You've seen the election of one or two women in New York and so on, who are clearly well to the left of people like Clinton. And although Bernie Sanders didn't succeed, although to some extent he was cheated of his success, I would think because the Republican Party now has become associated with Trump and his ideas, with right-wing Christian fundamentalism and so on, I think there's a sign that the Democratic Party, a bit like the Labour Party in England,
mm-hmm.
and maybe drifting a bit to the left, with younger people coming in and pulling it to the left. So that, you know, you worry about things like Trump, and you worry about the populism in parts of Europe as well. I mean, the guy in Hungary was clearly close to fascism. But politics tends to go in swings. Mm-hmm. And, you know, perhaps we're in a bad time just now, but maybe in a few years we'll see. But, you know, we could, an independent Scotland next to a Labour-controlled England, you know, mm-hmm. might be a reasonable future to look forward to. And maybe people like Trump may be replaced by some, you know, left-leaning liberal women in the United States. Could completely change the whole thing. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't need to lose faith, I don't think. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not that bad. It's quite bad.
we spoke about, you know, that right-wing agenda, and obviously we had Bannon appearing at the conference in Edinburgh this week, and it looks like the BBC are continuing to get things wrong when we saw Andrew Neil attack the Guardian journalist Carol Cadwaller on Twitter. This social media stuff, abuse, just seems to be getting a bit out of control.
Yeah, I've got mixed feelings about that. I mean, I think you're correct in saying there are areas in which it has got out of control, and the experience of women in politics is clearly an area where something needs to be done about that. My own personal experience hasn't been particularly bad, and I wonder if that's just more evidence that it is women who are receiving much of the flak. I'm very rarely trolled, astonishingly rarely trolled. I think that social media is to some extent, you know, just the kind of context in which we operate just now. Mm-hmm. And it's easy to kind of blame something that's new as an easy way of explaining something that seems to be becoming worse. Mm. Clearly, this social media allows more people to get in there and say what they like. And lots of unpleasant stuff is going on there. But equally, there's a lot of very positive things happening with social media. People who didn't have voices before are able to speak. And so, overall, I take the view something needs to be done about these excesses, obviously. Mm-hmm. And it's shameful that someone like Andrew Neil, you know, paid for out of our licences at quite a high level of pay, I don't know what it is, but probably pushing a million, that someone like him is able to say the kind of things he's said before and keep his job. I mean, I think it's astonishing. I think that there have been campaigns to remove people like him before, and they tend to fail because the BBC, in the end, is quite resistant to any kind of pressure from its own licence payers. But I would have said that Andrew Neil is someone who needs focus and needs people to collectively do something about him, because he's maybe satisfying the views of some people, but I think a lot of people are unhappy with him now.
I think he's just, you know, a man of a certain age who has grown up in, you know, with extreme entitlement, who has found himself, you know, in a position of some power. Because, you know, he has a great following, and he is opening his mouth and letting his belly rumble, and he's forgetting that when you put something out onto social media, it's out there for everybody to see. And that's I like the fact that Andrew Neil has done this week, because that's the kind of stuff that Andrew Neil would have been sitting in a restaurant in Mayfair, you know, saying in private, and none of us would be able to address it. So the fact that you know, he is misunderstanding and misusing his Twitter is actually useful, because we then get to address it, because this is all the stuff that's been happening for years. Mm. This is plain, good old-fashioned, you know, misogyny and entitlement, and the fact that social media is exposing that, even if they're doing it themselves, I think is, you know, a benefit to us, because then we can address it.
Mm. Do you think, Lisa, that women are more prone to getting trolled on social media?
I think it really depends. I mean, if I look at my kids, both kids have been subject to horrific trolling on social media for completely different things. One's a boy, one's a girl. So I think it's really easy to say that women, you know, are subject to more negative stuff on social media. Women are subject to more negative stuff, full stop. You know, whether it's social media, whether it's in business, whether it's, you know, as a driver, it actually doesn't matter. All that social media is doing is replicating what happens in life. So, you know, I don't think that social media is necessarily the cause. It's just a conduit for it to happen in another way.
Yeah, I agree, it's not the cause. Would you not say there have been some improvements in some of these other areas, like employment and so on, where the behaviour of men towards women has been improved in certain areas?
Of course.
I work in a university, and there's
of course, I would never suggest for 1 minute that we haven't improved things over the years. But at the same time, I'm not going to accept that everything's solved, because it's
no.
I mean, you only need to look at these women in Glasgow that have been fighting for equal pay for such a long time to see it's still a problem. Yeah. So, and it's a problem that permeates every aspect of society, whether it's domestic life, business life, social life, it's an issue. Yeah. So the fact that, you know, Andrew Neil has behaved badly on social media, for me, is kind of like, so what? Because they're auditing it. You know, he's just one of them.
But we're paying for him through the licence fee. We're paying quite a lot for him, so that's
another issue.
Yeah.
You know, that's
maybe a nice excuse to get rid of him.
Well, if there's the willingness to get rid of him. But, you know, I'm not convinced that there is the willingness to get rid of him, because actually lots of people really like him, and that's the pretty scary thing.
Well, the BBC, of course, the BBC won't release viewing figures very often unless there's something favourable to them. But he, on the politics show, he presents one day, and typically sexist, I can't remember the name of the woman who replaces him, but I wonder if they have the viewing figures for the 2 days to compare. Mm-hmm. It would be interesting to see. Mm-hmm. I find when she's on, I don't have any sense of losing anything at all. Mm-hmm. And I think she copes, she's quite forceful, quite assertive. Would be interesting to see whether there is actually any real basis for the BBC saying, mm-hmm. like Top Gear, we need to keep them because they're making us money and people are watching and so on. I'm not always sure if that's true.
I suspect that it's similar types of people who are making those budgeting decisions to Andrew Neil, and it's very much a cabal who are making these decisions. So I don't know that it is necessarily always entirely replicated in viewing figures. Mm. And in fact, viewing figures can be improved, or, you know, simply by the method of promoting something that somebody is on. So people can create the viewing figures that they want or don't want.
You mentioned, John, about the working environment having improved over the years. Is there a danger with Brexit and as losing some of the protections that we have, that we could end up going backwards?
Well, I think that's everyone's anxiety, is if we drop out hard of from the European Union, which has so many well-developed policies in that area, we end up with a North American approach to life, which takes away many of the protections that women have, that workers have, that the disabled have, and so on. I see a real danger, especially if services become open to bids from North American companies, and we see, you know, the situation in hospitals or amongst cleaners and so on. We see a worsening of already quite challenging circumstances, limited protection, lower hourly rates and so on, environmental risks not being dealt with properly. I see that as a real risk in dropping out of the EU's protection in that area.
You mentioned, Lisa, about those making the decisions and the cabal, I think you called them. But the reality is there's a handful of billionaire media barons who are setting the agenda for their establishment pals. Would you say that was accurate?
I think it is, but I don't think it's anything any different from whatever, you know, what has happened before. I think the media has always been owned and controlled by, you know, a very small, tight group of elite people. I think the difference nowadays is that the representation of different voices has narrowed. You know, I don't think we're getting the same breadth of discussion that we perhaps once enjoyed before. And that's why, you know, newspapers are not selling anywhere near as well. And, you know, the media barons are trying to think about how they can generate income from these publications in a different way. So I don't think it's necessarily any different. I think what has happened now is we see it differently. You know, we can recognise it. We have many more tools in society to actually identify where this is happening and to expose it. So I think it's subject to more scrutiny. But I don't know whether the people who are picking up the papers and reading them actually care about whether they're being manipulated or not, because they're probably focused on how they're going to get through to their next payday with their limited, I'm talking about the kind of really rubbish tabloids here, how they're going to get through to their next payday with their limited income, and then the paper's going to tell them other people that they can blame for that.
There is not in every area, but there are one or two areas in which there has actually been objective change. I mean, if you go back 40, 50 years ago, there were newspapers supporting the Labour Party in campaigns. I mean, the press is almost entirely right-wing corporation, Tory supporting. There were Labour newspapers back in the 1940s, and so most of these were pushed out of business by a very aggressive movement in the right-wing press to go downstream in terms of intellectual ideas. So you had the newspapers talking about politics back in the 1940s and 50s and so on, that by the 1980s were just really dealing with with sexual imagery and with you know, with scandals. So that's been a real change. I mean, there's been a removal of serious media in that period from the 1940s through to the 60s and 70s. And that was a result of aggression by the right-wing press.
Obviously, this week we saw the Scotsman get into administration, although I think they've been rescued by Johnson Press. But our newspapers are dying thing, John, is that not the media that we're... A lot of newspapers are, again, you said, I think you said it, but the TV people, they're not giving us the figures about what's the reality out there. You know, is it a dying...
Well, it does look that way in some respects. I mean, there are some exceptions to that general comment that, you know, it's a dying business. And the first exception is the business of local newspapers. The Dundee Courier and the Aberdeen Press and Journal are quite robust because they have a local focus, because they serve a purpose that people seem to feel they can only get from them. The other thing is that this is particularly interesting from a point of view of the Scottish movement for independence. And that's that the collapse in newspapers has been greater in Scotland than just about anywhere else in Europe. The Belgian media, the Belgian press is still doing quite well, a country of similar size. It's the same across Scandinavia. They're losing readers, but they're not plummeting the way the Scottish press have. So you have to think, well, what could explain the difference between the Scottish press and the Belgian or Scandinavian press? And the obvious thing is the constitution. That the Scottish press have largely said, we don't care about 45 to 50% of our readers, the ones who support independence. We're going to continue to push this negative, often very distorted propaganda in favour of the Union. And then they look around and see they've lost half the readers, and we think, well, it's no wonder. So it's more complex, but clearly, isn't it? Clearly, print-based media are declining.
I mean, both of you were involved in the independence referendum in 2014. And given where we are now with the press, do you think at the next referendum there is not going to be as much influence in terms of the media, because people are finding out, they're getting themselves more informed and more educated?
Well, that's an optimistic view, and I'd probably agree with it. That it seems rational that if less newspapers are being sold, then there'll be less influence there. I think that's an optimistic point of view. The other optimistic point of view, of course, is that many of the people who voted no will be dead. I know that's not a very tasteful thing to say, but I'm one of the older ones who didn't vote no. But I mean, you must assume that unless people become no voters as they get older, that must improve things. But I think the other point about that is something that I touched on earlier. I think we're getting to the point now with the remaining no supporters, that there are no supporters not because of things they've read in the newspapers recently. There are no supporters because they had a kind of education at school, because they grew up with parents, because they're part of a culture which is unionist, where these are deeply held, inarticulate values, and they're almost impossible to turn around. People want them. In some ways, the more you talk at them, the more you tell them, the more evidence you provide them, the more they dig their heels in and say, you know, not listening, So, I'd be a wee bit optimistic about that, but maybe not too.
Do you think, I mean, obviously more people are getting their news online as well, though, so...
I think there's a risk there, though, because there's a real... there's a bit of a tendency for people to exist in echo chambers, you know, and it's really important that when we are you know, using social media or using other forms of media, that we don't fall into that trap. We need to be able to address and counter the arguments of those that we are, you know, fighting against or campaigning against. And there's a real risk if we just exist in our own wee worlds that we will not be sufficiently skilled at actually being able to counter those arguments, because we won't have we'll have ignored them too much. I mean, the person that I was talking about earlier on the show, who had previously been who had voted to leave, you know, had voted for Brexit, we had a really, really interesting conversation, because he exists in an echo chamber, and the conversation led from Brexit, and he said to me, So what is Nicola doing up here then? Because all he heard from his social group was this really, really negative stuff. And then throughout the conversation, it wasn't so much about Nicola, she's just a figurehead as far as he's concerned. We were able to have a much more frank and open discussion about, you know, the positive benefits of being in Scotland just now, as opposed to some of the things that he was experiencing, you know, further south. but it was only his willingness to engage in that conversation that allowed us to, and I'm not saying he necessarily changed his mind, but there needs to be, you know, a mechanism where we can respectfully discuss things with each other, whether to, you know, degenerating into, you know, that kind of old West of Scotland finger pointing, you know, hugely negative style of campaigning that we've seen. We need to listen to those who we oppose. We need to hear them.
Yeah, because obviously, I mean, people who voted one way or another in 2014 did with the best intentions at the time, because that was the information they had, and they thought that was the right thing to do. But how do we get more information out to people if you are limited with the media that's out there that's only given one direction? How do we have that conversation with people and open up the debate more? We shouldn't be afraid to debate.
Well, I mean, it is happening on social media. I mean, despite the reservations people have about social media, I mean, social media is awash with yes thinking, very much. And then, you know, in the assessment of political blogs, the top 10 political blogs are all yes supporting. This is measured in terms of their audience. I mean, there is no major right wing political blog, anti independence right wing blog in Scotland. I mean, there's Guido Fox in England, but that's the only one. So, I wonder if there is any more that we need to do. Maybe we just need to be patient. I mean, it was a very quick surge to 45%. Mm-hmm. You know, I speak as someone who was, you know, was interested in all of this back in the 1960s. Mm-hmm. And when I was in sixth year at school, I was the only person in sixth year of the whole group who was prepared at the debating society to represent the SNP position. Mm-hmm. I was the only one. There was nobody else would have considered it. Now, and support for the SNP, what was it, 3-5% at times back then? We're at 40-odd percent for the party, and more than that for the Yes campaign. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's been a big change in a very short period of time. Mm-hmm. Maybe we need to, I mean, I'd like to see things happen quickly because, you know, I'm getting older, but maybe we just need to be a bit calm about it and think, well, it is actually shifting. Mm-hmm. It is shifting. We keep on pushing gently, but if you push too hard, you end up alienating people, mm-hmm. as you've suggested yourself. So, I've lost track of what the question was.
No, that's right.
Classic academic.
That's right.
It was an excellent question and answer.
Sure. Yeah. Well, you were listening to
me. Oops, things, yeah. So this week we've had a concern about a microchip company who told the Sunday Telegraph that they're in talks with several UK companies, allegedly, about fitting microchips to their employees. Do you find that a bit alarming, Lisa?
There is no way in this earth that I am ever working for someone who wants to put a microchip into my body. The whole thing is just ridiculous. And it was interesting reading the information, because the guy who is promoting this, the guy who owns the company, is a former body piercer.
Okay.
Right? So he has come from a position where he is, you know, putting things into people's bodies, and that's fine because they are actively and willingly participating in that. He's now, you know, marketing this as, you know, it's just going to make your life so much easier. You'll just wave your hand in front of the door and the door will miraculously open, all of which might in fact be true. But, you know, we at some level have already surrendered a lot of our information and our data to people who are faceless and we don't know. Mm-hmm. Because if you've got Google Maps on your phone, then, you know, everything that you ever do in your whole entire life can be tracked. If anybody is bored enough to look at my life, you know, they can do it. There's something really disturbing about the idea of an employer requiring an employee to have an embedded chip in their body, because that then can potentially lead to a level of control that that we should not surrender. You know, I find it incredibly uncomfortable. It's you know, I'm happy to have a microchip in my dog, because if she gets lost and somebody finds her, then she'll come back to me. But I'm no planning on getting lost as an employee and needing to be scanned and returned back to my employer. So
I think it links into what we spoke earlier on, John, about you know, that loss of workers' rights, and right? You know, once you've kind of gone down that road, then what happens if you don't agree to a chip? Do you not get the job? Or you know, it's dangerous territory. I
think there'll be a lot of resistance to that because of the kind of invasion of the body, you know. I think so. I mean, I wonder how serious a threat this is at the moment. But as you pointed out in your answer, there is already a very high level of surveillance, which we have voluntarily leapt into and accepted through our mobile phones and through our activity on Facebook and Twitter and so on. It's possible for groups to look at what we do and produce a very accurate picture of who we are and what we're likely to do next already. And the mobile phone is, as you say, I mean, if the Syrian government want to take out a reporter and in the civil war there, then all they need to, is for her phone to be switched on, and they can put a missile right down the room and blow her up, and they've done that already. So so I wonder if in some ways the game has been sold anyway, through our willing adoption of new technology that were largely supervised anyway, and seen and known.
Is that been one step closer to normalising this kind of thing? It's almost like the Matrix is here now.
That's right.
I think what you said is quite interesting. It's the invasion of the body.
Yeah.
That's where that's the difference.
Yeah.
Because we elect to have phones.
Yeah.
And if we choose not to, then we can we can switch it off, we can shut it down, and we can leave it at home. But you can't do that with a microchip.
No.
You know, once it's there, it's there. And I'm sure it can be removed. Even the process of removal is an invasive procedure. So it's the fact that it's required by an employer, potentially.
Yeah.
And once it's there, it's there.
And
all of these things are, you know, if they're used for good, then fair enough. But as history has taught us, that you know, the ability to scrutinise and keep records, and you know who is where and what that person is all about, you know, can lead to very, very, very devastating consequences. Yeah. So, you know, if that's where we're moving to, Corri, I'm getting my caravan and I'm heading for the hills. I'm no part of this anymore.
What if the chip, however, was monitoring your health? And of course, you know, and if you were in danger of having a heart attack, maybe one of your ears would flash or something.
I mean, this is stuff that, but this is stuff that I've heard when it comes to smart meters. You know, the whole idea of smart meters can monitor your energy use, and if you've got somebody who's suffering from dementia, and you can see that they're putting a cup of tea on at 3 o'clock in the morning, then it sends a message to their family. But why, that sounds fantastic if it's used appropriately. But as if it's used appropriately, you know, these things have the potential to be used and to be, you know, to be manipulated and to be exploited for very, very negative reasons. So,
absolutely.
I'm out.
Yeah, me too.
Well, on a slightly lighter note, it's been a bit of a heavy topic this week. I think you blogged about this earlier on in the week, John. The Carnegie Trust has done the first ever quantitative survey about kindness in communities and public service, and it showed that the experience of kindness was most common in England and least in most common in Scotland and least in England, and in services it was highest in Scotland and lowest in England. Does this show, John, a clear difference between Scotland and England in terms of our values and behaviour?
Well, that's a very sensitive issue. It's one I've been writing about quite a lot in my blog. I think there is a difference. It's not a huge thing. Clearly not everybody in Scotland is different from everybody in England. And I did in my blog on one occasion, I did suggest we should have a kind of transfer of populations. We could take a million of our, I used a bad word, a-holes, and swap them for a million good people from south of the border who held these kind of slightly left of centre, caring, communitarian sort of views. I think there's enough evidence to say that there's a bit of a difference here, and because you see in a lot of places, you can see in the levels of charitable giving and the willingness to donate organs. You can see in the level of employers offering living wages. You can see in a huge range of things. You can see it in levels of racism. I forget. I mean, I've written about so many of these sub issues. I think you put them all together, there's a bit of a difference here, and it's something which really annoys the BBC, I think, because the BBC does their best wherever possible to remind us we're just the same, so that when we read about stabbings in London, we immediately get something on reporting Scotland about anything they can find, and that then generalised into a kind of message, you're just the same. You know,
but actually, when I looked at the report, the numbers are not that different. You know, the headline number about, you know, people who feel that they have experienced kindness were across all of the component parts of the British Isles were in the 90s, which I thought was a fantastic figure. Yeah. I don't want to get caught up in this whole thing, but, you know, we're a bit special up here, and we're much cooler and nicer to people. You know, everybody's experience is different, and, you know, I certainly don't know enough about the reasons why the statistics pertaining to England came out the way they are. There might be something completely different to, you know, just that we're nicer up here that's actually created that. But what I was really interested in was some of the discussions around the kindness within public services, because, you know, I chair an audit committee within a public body, and one of the things that I'm really interested in is that, you know, how do we audit culture? You know, how do we embed kindness and positive culture, not just for the people that you're delivering services to, but for staff as well. And that's where I think, you know, the real gains could be made in using this particular report, because most people are actually all right. You know, if you fall down in the street, more than likely, if somebody's about, they're going to come and help you get up. You know, that is an act of kindness, but it's just like common decency. Where I think this kind of thing could really have huge impact is within organisations and public bodies. We were talking about universal credit earlier on, and one of the things that I think it was actually the rapporteur mentioned was that one of the regional leads in the DWP had been able to affect some kind of positive change through changing culture, and people there were getting better outcomes. So there's something about leadership within organisations creating the circumstances where kindness can. And the, you know, I always like to defer to the great Queen Lady Gaga, who you know, was famous for saying the great thing about kindness is that it's free. It doesn't cost anything.
And on that nice note, that's all we've got time for today. So that's us for this week. Thank you to John and Lisa, and thanks to you for watching at home. For more information about Broadcasting Scotland and our programmes, you can visit our website at broadcastingscotland.scot. And while you're there, you can also donate whatever you can to our crowdfunder. We're trying to raise £30,000, which will allow us to continue to make the full Scottish and produce new programmes. We're now halfway through, and thanks to everyone who's donated so far. Look out for Scotland at 7 and throughout the week, and also we'll be back for the full Scottish next Sunday. So enjoy the rest of your Sunday, and be kind to yourself and be kind to others.